So the topic for today is application of Bohr's theory on hydrogen spectrum. So this is the topic for today. So what we'll do is, I mean, we'll just consider the basic parameters that we studied in the Bohr's theory. So what is the excited state? What is the ground state, right? And we'll try to relate that to a hydrogen atom and how that thing will work in a hydrogen spectrum. So whenever a hydrogen electron gets excited and it falls back to its original ground state, so what is the amount of energy that is released, right? And what they say. So we'll just take one assumption now. So we assume that the electron in hydrogen is initially excited. So this means that the hydrogen electron in the hydrogen atom, initially when we are first considering the hydrogen atom, the electron is excited. So since the electron is excited, it will not be able to stay in that state for long, right? Nothing can stay in the excited state for too long. So what will happen is that electron, which is in the excited state, falls back to its ground state. Falls back to its ground state. Now, let us assume that this energy is EI, or initial energy, and the ground state energy to be EF. Now, as the electron falls down from its excited state to the ground state, some amount of energy is released. Some amount of energy is released, and that energy is denoted by H nu. So we denote that energy as H nu, where this nu is the frequency of the radiation. Frequency of radiation. So what are the considerations? EI is the initial state of the electron that is in the excited state. EF is the final state of the electron that is in the final or the parent state or the ground state. H nu is the energy of the radiation that is being removed, like the amount of energy that is removed when an electron falls from its excited state to the ground state, where nu is the frequency of the radiation. Now, before going on further, I'll just clear one concept. What is frequency? So what is the unit of frequency? Frequency is 1 by seconds,
Second.
right? 1 by seconds. Now, frequency can be related to velocity of light c as velocity equal to displacement by time, right? Now, 1 by time is nothing but frequency. So basically, speed of light is lambda times frequency. Because 1 by t is frequency, you know, and frequency unit is 1 by second. So 1 by time is frequency. So velocity of light is wavelength into frequency. Or we can say this frequency is equal to c by lambda. So I'm just taking lambda down, c by lambda. This frequency is c by lambda. So now, continuing with this, we know that the energy released is EI minus EF equal to H nu, right? H nu. Now we know what is E. We have a formula for E that we derived in the previous class. So we derived that E is equal to negative of 1 by n square m e to the power 4 whole divided by 8 epsilon naught square h square. 8 epsilon naught square h square. So this was the energy that we derived in the previous class. Now what will EI be? EI will be equal to minus 1 by ni squared m e to the power 4 8 epsilon naught square into h square. What will EF be? EF will be the final energy that is in the ground state, 1 by nf squared m e to the power 4 divided by 8 epsilon naught square into h square. Now what do we know? We know that h nu equal to EI minus EF. So h nu equal to EI is basically nothing but this and this, right? So EI is this, EF is this. So this negative will turn into positive. So this negative will turn into positive because we have one negative here. So we can just write it something like this. So we can write, take all these things common, ME square, 8 epsilon, ME to the power 4, sorry, 8 epsilon naught square into H square, common. 1 by NF square will be positive, negative will be 1 by NE square. So is this clear? So what I did is, so since there is a negative sign here, so this negative sign will make this sign positive, and this sign will stay negative still, right? Because there is no negative sign in front of EI. So this negative will put a negative on NE square, right? So this is not plus, this is negative only, NE square. So this is the energy of the radiation that is removed once the electron comes from its excited state to the ground state. So ME to the power 4, 8 epsilon naught square into H square, whole multiplied by 1 by NF square minus 1 by NE square. Now what we do is, we know what is frequency. So frequency, we had derived one thing. Where is that? So we had derived frequency as C by lambda, right? We had derived frequency as C by lambda. So we get H into C by lambda equal to M e to the power 4 divided by 8 epsilon naught square H square 1 by N S square minus 1 by N E square, right? So we get this. Now what we do is, we rearrange for lambda, I think. Yeah, we rearrange for lambda and find the value of lambda. H square becomes HC, H cube. Yeah. So what we do is, we rearrange for lambda, we keep this, the 1 by lambda here itself, and we try to solve it. So what is the final formula that we got? H into C by lambda equal to M e to the power 4 divided by 8 epsilon naught square into H square 1 by NF square minus 1 by NE square. So what we do is, we keep 1 by lambda here, we take C and H here, so we get M e to the power 4 8 epsilon naught square into HC 1 by NF square minus 1 by NE square. So basically we get 1 by lambda equal to, this whole thing is written as R, 1 by NF square minus 1 by NE square. So this R is known as Rydberg's constant, Rydberg, Rydberg's constant. And its value is always ME to the power 4, 8 epsilon naught square into HC, always. So this is the Rydberg's constant. We get the relation for 1 by lambda equal to R times 1 by NF square minus 1 by NE square. So I think this is clear, right? Is it clear? This derivation? So we are trying to find the wavelength of the emitted light. So if we can find the wavelength of the emitted light, we can classify which type of electromagnetic radiation it is, right? So if the wavelength falls under the visible light category, so it is a part of visible light. So we can actually see the color of the light. So when the transition is happening and when the energy is getting released, we can actually see the color that is being emitted if it is a part of the visible spectrum. Now, if it is not a part of the visible spectrum, it's a part of infrared spectrum. If this wavelength is a part of infrared spectrum, then we'll need some infrared sensors to detect the infrared lights, right? And if it's a part of ultraviolet spectrum, we need some ultraviolet sensors to find the light that is being emitted from the hydrogen spectrum, right? So now, this all led to one simple conclusion. So let us assume this is the ground state of hydrogen, right? This is the ground state of hydrogen. Then we have a second energy state. Then we have, let's say, a third energy state. Then we have fourth energy state. Then we have fifth energy state. Then we have sixth energy state, something like this. Now I derived the value of energy for these all these states, right? So we can take we can take any value. We can take we can find the value of all the like energy states. Like if this is n equal to 1, this is n equal to 2, this is n equal to 3, this is 4, this is 5, this is 6, this is 7. So we can find the energy of each orbit. So I found that energy of first orbit is minus 13.58 eV, right? Second one will be minus 13.58 divided by n squared. So you get the value of 3 point something. Yeah, minus 3.39. Minus 3.39. So yesterday you can get the value. So now what happened is the study of Bohr's theory to explain hydrogen spectrum led to this discovery of hydrogen spectrum lines. So whenever an electron falls back from any outer state to n equal to 1, that is the ground state, right? This series is known as the Lehmann series of hydrogen spectrum. So when the electrons of hydrogen falls back from any other state to n equal to 1, then this series of spectral lines is known as Lehmann's series. Okay, I'll not write it here, it'll not fit. I'll write it here. So this is known as Lehmann apostrophe as Lehmann's series. Okay, now if the same movement happens but now a little bit different, so what is the difference is, so from any other state it drops back to n equal to 2. So it can come from any value of orbit, any orbit number, right? But it has to drop down to n equal to 2. So this becomes the Balmer series. Balmer apostrophe S. Balmer's series. Yeah, Balmer series. So it can drop from any number of orbital lines. So it can drop from 7, 8, 9, 6, 7, whatever it is. But it has to fall back to 2. It should not go below 2. So if it falls back to 2, it is Balmer series. Then after that, we have three more. If it comes from any other spectral lines, any other orbit, it comes from any other orbit and falls back to n equal to 3. Right? So it falls back to n equal to 3 ultimately. So this is known as the Passan series. Yeah. Passan. Passan series. Next, similarly, if it falls to the fifth orbit, so if it falls to the fifth orbit from any higher orbit, it falls to fifth. And this becomes the bracket series. So this is known as BRACKETS, bracket series. And the last one is, if it falls from any higher orbit to n equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? Now n equal to 5. Yeah, when it drops to n equal to 5, this is the last series that you need to know in your standard. This is known as the Pfund series. Pfund series. So this is the application of Bohr's theory to hydrogen spectrum. So according to Bohr's theory, we had concluded that electrons can go to higher energy levels when they gain energy, and they will come back to lower energy level when they lose energy. So this theory, when applied to hydrogen spectrum, we get this 5 series. Only this 5 is there in the syllabus. There is more than 5 as well. There is one 6 wala, there is one emission spectrum called the 6, I don't know the name, there is a 6 one and a greater 6. So everything above 6 is known as a greater 6. There is no specific name for above 6. So there is a name for 6 when the electron falls back to orbit number 6, right? But I don't know the name, I forgot. But for your syllabus it's only till 5. So when any excited electron falls back to its ground state where n equal to 1, then that kind of series is known as the Lehman series. When any excited electron falls back to n equal to 2, so it just falls back from any higher orbit level to n equal to 2, then that series is known as the Balmer series, right? If any electron from any higher series falls back to n equal to 3, it's known as the Paschen series. Similarly, if it falls back to 4, it's known as brackets, and when it falls back to n equal to 5, is known as the Pfund series. Okay, so this should be clear. So this is the hydrogen spectrum. This might be asked in a long answer question. Explain the Bohr's theory by giving suitable examples relating to hydrogen spectrum, or they can just ask explain Bohr's theory in detail. So if they ask like that, so you can explain all the energy derivations, right? You derived radius, we derived velocity, we derived energy, right? And we derived what will be the energy of the radiation that is being emitted when an electron falls back from a higher energy state to a lower energy state. So that was h nu, right? So we found what is the value of h nu, and we also found the value of 1 by lambda. So we found the value of the lambda, the wavelength of the light, that wavelength of the radiation that will be released as a result of electron dropping from a higher energy state to a lower energy state, right? So we did all those. So if this is asked something like this, if Bohr's theory is asked, and if they have not specified hydrogen spectrum, even if you write this, you'll get it's not wrong at all, because it's just a direct application of Bohr's theory. But you have to write about the Bohr's theory first. Bohr's theory, what are the radius formulas, what are the velocity formula, what is the energy formula, and all those things. So you have to write all those and come to this, right? So this is hydrogen spectrum as a direct application of Bohr's theory. Now there are some elements that are hydrogen-like, okay? There are some elements that are hydrogen-like. So what does this mean? Hydrogen-like, it should have the same number of electrons. So hydrogen has one electron, right? So a singly ionized helium, right? So if we know helium has two protons and two electrons. So if it is a singly ionized helium, so one electron will go out, so we get He plus. Now this resembles similar to that of a hydrogen. Note that the nucleus will not be the same, but the electron configuration will be similar to that of hydrogen, right? So these elements can also undergo the same spectrum that I told you. These also can undergo hydrogen-like spectrum. But the only difference they will have is, I'll give you an example with the energy formula. So we had an energy formula which stated En equal to minus 1 by n square me to the power 4 divided by 8 epsilon naught square into h square. Now we just directly assume that the charge of the hydrogen atom is E, right? E as the electron, and negative E as the electron, and positive E as the proton. But now the nucleus is not a single proton, so we can have two protons in helium, or we can have like triply ionized lithium, triply or doubly ionized lithium, like plus plus plus. It will also have one electron, but its nucleus will have more than one proton, right? So now we can't use this formula to generalize hydrogen-like atom, because they may be similar to hydrogen in terms of electronic configuration, but their nucleus will be completely different. So what we do is, we just add a term Z to the picture. This basically Z is the atomic number, right? Atomic number is the number of protons or electrons number of protons in the nucleus. So Z is the number of protons in the nucleus. So what we do is e to the power 4. So we just replace in all the formulas, in place of just e to the e value to be kept alone, we multiply it with a term Z, where Z is the number of protons. Okay. So when you modify the formulas, you get something like this. Yes, Banatabai.
Helium ko to n orbit ma huncha ni.
Yes, okay.
Energy state minus 13.6858 electron volt hundaina hai. Duita proton tandachha ni.
Duita proton le tandacha bhandakheri, it may not be. Yeah, it can, it'll not be. You know, yeah, your z term aayo ni ta. Right. Hudaina. Minus 13.58 hudaina. माइनस 13.58 विल नॉट बी द एनर्जी ऑफ द थिंग. येस करेक्ट, यू आर करेक्ट, बिकॉज वी हैव एन एक्स्ट्रा टर्म जी इन द इक्वेशन, राइट? सो द ग्राउंड स्टेट एनर्जी इति हुँदैन. नाइस, करेक्ट, दिस करेक्ट.
एनर्जीको लागि होइन यो फर्मुला,
यो एनर्जीको लागि फर्मुला, बट वी आर जेनरलाइजिङ इट टु हाइड्रोजन लाइक एलिमेन्ट्स, नट हाइड्रोजन. सो दिस फर्मुला वाज ओन्ली फर हाइड्रोजन, राइट? अनि यो यो फर्मुलाले वी केम आउट टु अ कन्क्लुजन द्याट इएन इक्वल टु माइनस 13.58 टु द डिभाइडेड बाई एन स्क्वायर, राइट? सो दिस वाज स्ट्रिक्टली फर हाइड्रोजन ओन्ली. सो नाउ दिस भ्याल्यु विल चेन्ज इफ इट इज नट हाइड्रोजन. तिमीले भनेको ठिक है, वाट यु सेड इज करेक्ट. इट डिपेन्ड्स, इफ प्रोटोन प्रोटोन भ्याल्यु इज लाइक टू, इफ देयर आर टू प्रोटोन्स विल बी डबल, इफ इट इज फोर विल बी फोर टाइम्स, राइट? सो इल डिपेन्ड, इल डिपेन्ड अन वाट द नम्बर अफ प्रोटोन इज देयर, राइट? सो बट दिस मे नट बी टोटली करेक्ट, आई जस्ट एडेड दिस टर्म हियर. ओके, सो वी हेभ टु लाइक फर्दर स्टार्ट डिराइभिङ फ्रम द यो रेडियस टर्मबाटै यु हेभ टु स्टार्ट. सो आरएन विल बी आफ्टर डिराइभिङ, इट्स नट देयर, द डेरिभेसन इज नट देयर. सो इट इज एन स्क्वायर बाई जी इन्टु एन वान. सो एन वान इज बेसिकली द द वाट इज दिस, वाट इज एन वान, आई मीन आर वान. Can you tell me? So if I say that for hydrogen-like atoms, Rn equal to n square by z into R1. So what is R1?
Q1
So Mylani, after applying this theory for hydrogen-like atoms, I get the formula for Rn for those hydrogen-like atoms. Okay. So it is n square by z into R1. So what is this R1? So this R1 is nothing but the constant. So just a your radius ka formula, we had a constant, right? So we had something like Rn equal to n square into epsilon naught into h square divided by pi m e square, pi m e square. So we had this, right? But now we are just changing this as e ko badli. So for like in place of e, we need z e. So n square by z epsilon naught into h square divided by pi m e square. So in place of e, like in place of e, we introduce as z e. Now Rn will be equal to n square by z, n square by z into, now this thing is R1. So this is all the constant values we are putting as R1. So this will have a definite value, right? Because epsilon naught is constant, h is also constant, pi is constant, m is constant, e is constant, right? Abuja. So R1 भनेको यो हो. सो योर होमवर्क इज डिराइभ दिस सेम रिलेसन फर नन हाइड्रोजन एटम्स अर हाइड्रोजन लाइक एटम्स. फाइन्ड द एनर्जी फर्मुला, एनर्जी फर्मुला. सो वाट आई गेव गेभ यु लाइक प्रिभियसली, आई गेभ यु समथिङ लाइक दिस, राइट? इएन इक्वल टु आई पुट लाइक सिधै जी हालेर ई टु द पावर फोर गरेँ. सो दिस इज रङ, दिस इज नट करेक्ट. सो बिकज देयर आर फोर इज, दे आर नट टू इज, सो आई कान्ट जस्ट पुट जेड. सो यु हेड युनिट टु डिराइभ द एनर्जी फर्मुला एन्ड द वेलोसिटी फर्मुला. Velocity formula for hydrogen like atoms, not helium, hydrogen like atoms. Okay,
and I want to say individual element ko khojnu
bhayo. No, just put z. Aba individual element you can just put z ko value, right?
Generalize khojnu
bhanera, exactly. Just find a generalized formula for energy and velocity, that's it.
प्रॉपर
प्रकारले
डिराइभ
गर्नु भनेको, यस, प्रॉपर प्रकारले. सो वेन यु द्याट फर्मुला शुड बी युजफुल फर हाइड्रोजन एज वेल, फर एनी अदर एलिमेन्ट एज वेल. सो आई निड अ जेनरलाइज फर्मुला द्याट क्यान वर्क बोथ फर हाइड्रोजन एन्ड एनी अदर हाइड्रोजन लाइक एलिमेन्ट्स. ओके, सो आई निड द्याट काइन्ड अफ फर्मुला डेरिभेसन.
त्यसको लागि एनर्जी भेलोसिटी रेडियसको तिनटै,
एनर्जी भेलोसिटी रेडियस. मैले रेडियस त दिइसकेँ फर्मुला, बट यु डिराइभ दिस. ओके, हाउ यु हाउ टु कम इन दिस पोइन्ट, यहाँसम्म कसरी आइपुग्नु. ओके, सो ट्राई टु डिराइभ दिस. दिस भोलि देखाउँदा हुन्छ, एक्जाम छैन होइन, यु डोन्ट हैव एक्जाम्स, राइट? ओके, सो यु हेभ टु सो मी दिस बाई टुमोरो.